mentioned something about your mental preparation. Could you tell us a little bit about that? You know, Tokyo was a very unusual games for many reasons. So how did you mentally prepare for Tokyo?
Yeah, it was so different mentally. And I've had a lot of conversations about this after the games. I work with a sports psychologist from where I used to train in Oregon. And she was really instrumental in helping me sort of visualize and come up with different strategies for what I was going to encounter in Tokyo, even before my knee blew up. It was very different. You didn't have your support team behind you. Usually, you know, there are your coaches or family or people that, you know, you're sort of used to being surrounded by. You have that outlet if, you know, if they're able to travel to the games. So this was, it was really different. We weren't allowed to leave the village. We weren't really allowed to, you know, congregate. And I think that could take a big toll on mental preparation because you're on all the time, right? Like you're in the village, you're in your little cardboard bed. They're really, you know, there's not areas to sort of sit and lounge around because you're discouraging congregation. So I think for me, it was really important that I went in, I had books to read, I had shows that I was planning to watch, I had, you know, different self-care things. I had nail polish, I had sheet masks, I had, you know, I was doing all that kind of stuff that makes me feel good.
Right.
And luckily I had some training partners. I had three training partners in the village. Mm-hmm. So we made a point to meet for our meals and sort of linger and chat, and just trying to keep my natural routine that I work with. And then the second part that I was dealing with a wild injury was just managing everything I could and letting go of the rest. The outcome wasn't going to be what I wanted it to be. And I had to release that early and just focus on, okay, what can I do today to get me on that line in August? And that it wasn't what it normally looked like. I wasn't going out on my normal, you know, 6 mile easy jogs or, you know, doing my track workouts, doing my strides to feel ready. You know, I would go bike in the gym and then I would ice down, or I would go run for 10 minutes and ice down, and just sort of doing those little things that I could control, and letting what I couldn't control go, I think helped me feel sane and happy and fulfilled at the games.
I'm happy you said this about utilizing a sports psychologist, because in your case, you're working with two different things, right? Transitioning to a games that's unusual for track and field athletes in terms of what you're allowed to do, but also managing the injury. And so is this a person you've been working with for a very long time? And how does that play a role in your development as an athlete?
Yeah, so I started working with her. My psychologist's name is Dr. Melissa Todd out of Eugene, Oregon. And I started working with her right before the Olympics in 2016. So I think it was December of 2015. I was entering sort of the golden years of my career. And I thought, what can I do? You know, I check all these boxes for my physical health, but I firmly believe that so much of racing is actually mental.
Right.
And I'm so focused on my physical fitness. I need to be focused on my mental fitness and, you know, being able to step up to the line and be such a fierce competitor. How do I practice that? And so I started working with her, and I have worked with her almost every other week for, gosh, 5 years now.
Right. So
yeah.
Was there a moment that, you know, kind of triggered, oh, I need to go and talk to somebody? Or was it just, you know, you're examining your holistic approach towards competition and training and thought that this was something that was missing?
A little bit of both. A little bit of both. I graduated from college in 2012, and I had gotten, you know, incrementally better, but I hadn't really broken through to sort of where I thought my potential was as an athlete. And it was sort of in that examination of, okay, what can I do better? And I found that there was, you know, maybe a difference on race day versus me and my competitors. So I thought like, hey, why don't I try this? I don't have to stick with it if it doesn't seem like it's going to work for me. And then when I started working with her every year, I just got tougher and stronger and would, you know, show up to races where maybe I wasn't projected to win, kind of like Commonwealth Games. I knew I was a big underdog. Nobody even mentioned my name in the pre-race, you know, write-ups, but I knew what I could do, and I'd been working on it for so many years that I was able to go and win gold there. So I think it's my mental strength is now one of my superpowers, where when I was a young athlete, it definitely wasn't. I, even back in 2016 in Rio, my race was in the morning. I was up at 4:45 to go get my breakfast and wake up my body and my mind. And I remember sitting in the cafeteria with tears running down my cheeks because I was so nervous, so nervous for the race. So I dealt with so much pre-race anxiety that I just have been able to manage so much better as an older athlete, so that I'm not wasting energy crying in the cafeteria, right, like, you know, before my race. I'm showing up and I'm feeling good and I'm ready to go.